Friedrich Wilhelm Joseph Schelling, later von Schelling, was a German philosopher. Standard histories of philosophy make him the midpoint in the development of German idealism, situating him between Johann Gottlieb Fichte, his mentor in his early years, and Georg Wilhelm Friedrich Hegel, his former university roommate, early friend, and later rival. Interpreting Schelling's philosophy is regarded as difficult because of its apparently ever-changing nature. Schelling's thought in the large has been neglected, especially in the English-speaking world, as has been his later work on mythology and revelation, much of which remains untranslated. An important factor was the ascendancy of Hegel, whose mature works portray Schelling as a mere footnote in the development of idealism. Schelling's Nietzsche philosophy also has been attacked by scientists for its analogizing tendency and lack of empirical orientation. However, some later philosophers such as Martin Heidegger and Slavoj Žižek have shown interest in re-examining Schelling's body of work. Life. Early life. Schelling was born in the town of Leonberg in Württemberg, the son of Joseph Friedrich Schelling and his wife Gottliebin Marie. He attended the monastery school at Biebenhausen, near Tübingen, where his father was chaplain and an Orientalist professor. From 1783 to 1784 Schelling attended a Latin school in Nürtingen and knew Friedrich Hölderlin, who was 5 years his senior. At the age of 16, he then was granted permission to enroll at the Tübinger Stift, despite not having yet reached the normal enrollment age of 20. At the Stift, he shared a room with Hegel as well as Hölderlin, and the three became good friends. Schelling studied the Church Fathers and ancient Greek philosophers. His interest gradually shifted from Lutheran theology to philosophy. In 1792 he graduated from the philosophical faculty, and in 1795 he finished his thesis for his theological degree. Meanwhile, he had begun to study Kant and Fichte, who greatly influenced him. While tutoring two youths of an aristocratic family, he visited Leipzig as their escort and had a chance to attend lectures at Leipzig University, where he was fascinated by contemporary physical studies including chemistry and biology. At this time he also visited Dresden, where he saw collections of the Elector of Saxony, to which he referred later in his Thinking on Art. On a personal level, this Dresden visit of 6 weeks from August 1797 saw Schelling meet the brothers August Wilhelm Schlegel and Carl Friedrich Schlegel and his future wife Caroline, and Novalis. Yet a period after 2 years tutoring, in 1798, at the age of only 23, Schelling was called to Jena as an extraordinary professor of philosophy. His time at Jena put Schelling at the center of the intellectual ferment of Romanticism. He was on close terms with Johann Wolfgang von Goethe, who appreciated the poetic quality of the Nietzsche philosophy, reading von der Weltseele. As the Prime Minister of the Duchy of Saxe-Weimar, Goethe invited Schelling to Jena. On the other hand, Schelling was unsympathetic to the ethical idealism that animated the work of Friedrich Schiller, the other pillar of Weimar classicism. Later, in Schelling's Verlesung über die Philosophie der Kunst, Schiller's theory on the sublime was closely reviewed. In Jena, Schelling was on good terms with Fichte at first, but their different conceptions, about nature in particular, led to increasing divergence in their thought. Fichte advised him to focus on philosophy in its original meaning, that is, transcendental philosophy. Specifically, Fichte's own Wissenschaftlehre. But Schelling, who was becoming the acknowledged leader of the Romantic school, had begun to reject Fichte's thought as cold and abstract. Schelling was especially close to August Wilhelm Schlegel and his wife, Caroline. A marriage between Schelling and Caroline's young daughter, August Bohme, was contemplated by both. August died of dysentery in 1800, prompting many to blame Schelling, who had overseen her treatment. Robert Richards, however, argues in his book The Romantic Conception of Life that Schelling's interventions were not only appropriate but most likely irrelevant, as the doctor's call to the scene assured everyone involved that August's disease was inevitably fatal. August's death drew Schelling and Caroline closer. Schlegel had moved to Berlin, and a divorce was arranged. Schelling's time at Jena came to an end, and on 2 June 1803 he and Caroline were married away from Jena. Their marriage ceremony was the last occasion Schelling met his school friend Hölderlin, who was already mentally ill at that time. In his Jena period, Schelling had a closer relationship with Hegel again. With Schelling's help, Hegel became a private lecturer at Jena University. Hegel wrote a book titled Differenz des Fichtes Chen und Schelling's Chen, Systems der Philosophie, and supported Schelling's position against his idealistic predecessors, Fichte and Karl Leonhard Reinhold. Beginning in January 1802, Hegel and Schelling published the Kritisches Journal der Philosophie as co-editors, publishing papers on the philosophy of nature. But Schelling was too busy to stay involved with the editing, and the magazine was mainly Hegel's publication, espousing a thought different from Schelling's. The magazine ceased publication in the spring of 1803 when Schelling moved from Jena to Würzburg. Moved to Würzburg and personal conflicts after Jena, Schelling went to Bamberg for a time to study Brunonian medicine with Adalbert Friedrich Marcus and Andreas Richlaub. From September 1803 until April 1806, Schelling was professor at the new University of Würzburg. This period was marked by considerable flux in his views and by a final breach with Fichte and Hegel. In Würzburg, a conservative Catholic city, Schelling had many enemies among his colleagues and in the government. He moved to Munich in 1806, where he found a position as a state official, first his associate of the Bavarian Academy of Sciences and Humanities and secretary of the Royal Academy of Fine Arts, afterwards as secretary of the Philosophische Klasse of the Academy of Sciences. 1806 was also the year Schelling published a book in which he criticized Fichte openly by name. In 1807 Schelling received the manuscript of Hegel's Phenomenologie des Geistes, which Hegel had sent to him, asking Schelling to write the foreword. Surprised to find remarks directed at his own philosophical theory, Schelling eventually wrote back, asking Hegel to clarify whether he had intended to mock Schelling's followers who lacked a true understanding of his thought, or Schelling himself. Hegel never replied. In the same year, Schelling gave a speech about the relation between the visual arts and nature at the Academy of Fine Arts, and Hegel wrote a severe criticism of it to one of his friends. After that, they criticized each other in lecture rooms and in books publicly until the end of their lives. Munich period. Without resigning his official position in Munich, he lectured for a short time in Stuttgart and 7 years at Erlangen. In 1809 Caroline died, just before he published Freiheitsschrift, the last book published during his life. 3 years later, introduced by Goethe, Schelling married one of her closest friends, Pauline Gotter, in whom he found a faithful companion. During the long stay at Munich, Schelling's literary activity came gradually to a standstill. It is possible that it was the overpowering strength and influence of the Hegelian system that constrained Schelling, for it was only in 1834, after the death of Hegel, that, in a preface to a translation by Hubert Becker's of a work by Victor Cousin, he gave public utterance to the antagonism in which he stood to the Hegelian, and to his own earlier, conception of philosophy. The antagonism certainly was not then a new fact. The Erlangen Lectures on the History of Philosophy of 1822 express the same in a pointed fashion, and Schelling had already begun the treatment of mythology and religion, which in his view constituted the true positive complements to the negative, of logical or speculative philosophy. Berlin period. Public attention was powerfully attracted by these vague hints of a new system which promised something more positive, especially in its treatment of religion, than the apparent results of Hegel's teaching. the appearance of critical writings by David Friedrich Strauss, Feuerbach, and Bruno Bauer, and the evident disunion in the Hegelian school itself, express a growing alienation from the then-dominant philosophy. In Berlin, the headquarters of the Hegelians, this found expression in attempts to obtain officially from Schelling a treatment of the new system which he was understood to have in reserve. The realization of the desire did not come about till 1841, when the appointment of Schelling as Prussian Privy Councillor and member of the Berlin Academy gave him the right, a right he was requested to exercise, to deliver lectures in the university. The opening lecture of his course was listened to by a large and appreciative audience. The enmity of his old foe, H.E.G. Paulus, sharpened by Schelling's apparent success, led to the surreptitious publication of a verbatim report of the lectures on the philosophy of revelation, and, as Schelling did not succeed in obtaining legal condemnation and suppression of this piracy, he in 1845 ceased the delivery of any public courses, works. In 1793 Schelling contributed to Heinrich Eberhard Gottlob Paulus's Memorabilien. His 1795 dissertation was De Marcione Paulinarum Epistolarum Emendata, on the Pauline epistles according to Marcion of Sinope. In 1794, Schelling published an exposition of Fichte's thought entitled Über die Möglichkeit einer Form der Philosophie überhaupt. This work was acknowledged by Fichte himself and immediately earned Schelling a reputation among philosophers. His more elaborate work, Vom Ich als Prinzip der Philosophie, oder über das Unbedingte im Menschlichen Wissen, while still remaining within the limits of the Fichtean idealism, showed a tendency to give the Fichtean method a more objective application, and to amalgamate Spinoza's views with it. He contributed articles in reviews to the Philosophisches Journal of Fichte and Friedrich Emanuel Neothammer, and threw himself into the study of physical and medical science. In 1795 Schelling published Philosophische Briefe über Dogmatismus und Kritizismus, consisting of 10 letters addressed to an unknown interlocutor that presented both a defense and critique of the Kantian system. In the period 1796-7 there was written the seminal manuscript now known as the Altestesystemprogramm des Deutschen Idealismus. It survives in Hegel's handwriting. On its first publication by Franz Rosenzweig, it was attributed to Schelling. It has also been claimed for Hegel and Hölderlin. In 1797 Schelling published the essay Neue Deduction des Naturrechts, which anticipated Fichte's treatment of the topic in the Grundlage des Naturrechts. His studies of physical science bore fruit in the Ideen zu einer Philosophie der Natur and the treatise von der Weltseele. In Ideen Schelling referred to Leibniz and quoted from his Monadology. He held Leibniz in high regard because of his view of nature during his natural philosophy period. In 1800 Schelling published System des Transcendentalen Idealismus. In this book Schelling described transcendental philosophy and nature philosophy as complementary to one another. Fichte reacted by stating that Schelling was working on the basis of a false philosophical principle. In Fichte's theory nature as not self couldn't be a subject of philosophy, whose essential content is the subjective activity of the human intellect. The breach became unrecoverable in 1800, after Schelling published Darstellung des Systems meiner Philosophie. Fichte thought this title absurd, since in his opinion philosophy could not be personalized. Moreover, in this book Schelling publicly expressed his estimation of Spinoza, whose work Fichte had repudiated as dogmatism, and declared that nature and spirit differ only in the quantity, but are essentially identical. According to Schelling, the absolute was the indifference or identity, which he considered to be an essential subject of philosophy. The Aphorisms on Nature Philosophy, published in the Jahrbücher der Medizin als Wissenschaft, for the most part extracts from the Würzburg lectures. and the Denkmal der Schrift von den Gottliebenden des Herrn Jacobi was a response to an attack by Jacobi. A work of significance is the 1809 Philosophische Untersuchung und über das Wesen der menschlichen Freiheit und die Damit zusammenhangenden Gegenstände, which carries out, with increasing tendency to mysticism, the thoughts of the previous work, Philosophy and Religion. However, in a change from the Jena period works, now evil is not an appearance coming from the quantitative differences between the real and the ideal, but something substantial. This work clearly paraphrased Kant's distinction between intelligible and empirical character. Otherwise, Schelling himself called freedom a capacity for good and evil. The tract Über die Gottheit und zu Samothrake appeared in 1815. Ostensibly a portion of a greater work, Die Welt Alter, frequently announced as ready for publication, but of which little was ever written. Schelling planned Die Welt Alter as a book in three parts, describing the past, present, and future of the world. However, he began only the first part, rewriting it several times and at last keeping it unpublished. The other two parts were left only in planning. Christopher John Murray describes the work as follows: building on the premise that philosophy cannot ultimately explain existence, he merges the earlier philosophies of nature and identity with his newfound belief in a fundamental conflict between a dark unconscious principle in a conscious principle in God. God makes the universe intelligible by relating to the ground of the real, but insofar as nature is not complete intelligence, the real exists as a lack within the ideal and not as reflective of the ideal itself. The three universal ages, distinct only to us but not in the eternal God, therefore comprise a beginning where the principle of God before God is divine will striving for being. The present age, which is still part of this growth and hence a mediated fulfillment, and a finality where God is consciously and consummately himself to himself. No authentic information on the new positive philosophy of Schelling was available till after his death. His sons then began the issue of his collected writings with the four volumes of Berlin Lectures. Volume I, Introduction to the Philosophy of Mythology, E, Philosophy of Mythology, I, and V, Philosophy of Revelation. Periodization. Schelling at all stages of his thought called to his aid outward forms of some other system: Fichte, Spinoza, Jacob Bohme and the mystics, and finally, major Greek thinkers with their Neoplatonic, Gnostic, and Scholastic commentators, give coloring to particular works. In Schelling's own view, his philosophy fell into three stages. These were the transition from Fichte's method to the more objective conception of nature, i.e., the advance to nature philosophy, the definite formulation of that which implicitly, as Schelling claims, was involved in the idea of nature philosophy, that is, the thought of the identical, indifferent, absolute substratum of both nature and spirit, the advance to identitas philosophy, the opposition of negative and positive philosophy, an opposition which is the theme of his Berlin Lectures. Though its germs may be traced back to 1804, Nature philosophy. The function of Schelling's Nature philosophy is to exhibit the ideal as springing from the real. The change which experience brings before us leads to the conception of duality, the polar opposition through which nature expresses itself. The dynamical series of stages in nature are matter, as the equilibrium of the fundamental expansive and contractive forces, light, with its subordinate processes, organism, with its component phases of reproduction, irritability and sensibility,